Hey, so I just wanted to put a button on what we were talking about last week with David Hume. I gave you a lot about Kant, but I kind of left Hume up for you to explore yourself. So the main takeaway for Hume is that he's trying to solve the same sort of problem that Kant is. Namely, on the one hand, it seems like our judgments about beauty and artistic goodness seem very subjective. They're like judgments about which flavor of ice cream is best. Just different people have different feelings, and there's no real fact of the matter which one is right and which one is wrong. On the other hand, it seems like they really actually are objective. There's just an objective fact of the matter that the Beatles are better than Justin Bieber or Rebecca Black. And as Hume puts it, yeah, this is almost like it's an objective fact of the matter that a little puddle on the ground is smaller than the Atlantic Ocean. So he tries to figure out, well, how could there possibly be any kind of objective standard by which we could judge whether a piece of art is really good or really bad or actually beautiful or not? And the standard he comes up with eventually is this idea of the ideal judge. He says there are some people who are ideal judges of whether art is beautiful or good, and their judgment about whether art is good or beautiful is what sets the standard for whether art is in fact objectively good or beautiful. So then the question that he has is, well, what are the features of these ideal judges? What makes someone an ideal judge versus just a regular judge who might not really know the difference between good art and bad art, beautiful art or non-beautiful art? And Hume says, well, look, there are three different qualities that make for a good judge. The first one, he says, is that judges have a very high delicacy of sentiment. So by sentiment, he just means feeling or emotions, and delicacy, he just means, well, it's really subtle. They're able to discern really fine differences in different things. So he tells a story about these two folks who are able to discern that there was just an iron key and a leather strap at the bottom of a huge wine barrel, and even though everyone else is just like, I don't know, it just tastes like wine, they had this delicacy of sentiment where they were able to feel that feeling of the taste of the leather and the taste of the iron, even though there's only a little teeny tiny bit of it in this whole big vat of wine. My wife always makes fun of me because she drinks wine and she's like, I don't know, it tastes like red wine. And I taste it and I say, oh no, it has these nice notes of blackberry and subtle kumquat notes too. And she just looks at me like, how are you getting that? I guess I have a pretty delicate sentiment when it comes to wine for whatever reason. So that's the first thing a judge should be able to do. They should be able to pick up on the subtle differences of, say, color when it comes to paintings or sound when it comes to music. And secondly, an ideal judge should be free from all prejudice. So they should be able to judge the effect of a piece of work without getting their kind of societal, cultural baggage getting in the way. So for example, you know, maybe you grew up in like the early 2000s when people were pumping out a bunch of songs with auto-tune in them. And so because you have this sort of prejudice, you think, oh yeah, I really like songs with auto-tune. And if a song just doesn't have enough auto-tune in it, it's just not good to me. Well, you might suspect, yeah, that's kind of a prejudice on your part. There's plenty of really good music that just does not involve auto-tune. And so if you can only experience pleasure from listening to art with auto-tune, you're probably biased in that regard. I have kind of some biases. Like, I have some weird stuff with animation. Like, I don't know, like, I know a lot of people who are really into anime and think there's just some amazing art that's created with anime, and I don't know, for whatever reason, the anime style, I just kind of had this visceral, like, yeah, I just don't really like it. And I recognize that's got to be a prejudice on my part, because lots of people whose judgments I respect, they think it's really good, yet I just don't dig it. So you probably shouldn't go to me. I'm not an ideal judge when it comes to judging what sort of animation is good or bad, because I've got this prejudice kind of against anime for some reason. So we've got a delicacy of sentiment, this freedom from prejudice, and then the third thing Hume thinks is important for an ideal judge is this experience. you should have experience with lots of different kinds of art and examples of art, and in particular, you should have experience comparing new and different kinds of art. So you can think about this in terms of food, for example. You know, if you grow up in a culture in which all your food is like, I don't know, really bland, and then you taste something that has like a lot of seasoning in it, like some say like Northern Indian cuisine, you might be like, oh my God, how do people even eat this? It's so different than what I'm used to. Well, that might be one, an example of prejudice, but it might be two, just that, well, you don't have enough experience kind of recognizing the different ways that food can impress you, and so you don't really have a basis to judge. Indeed, you might in some respects just not have a good idea of how good stuff can be. So you can imagine playing Justin Bieber, say, for someone who lived in prehistoric times in a cave. Maybe they've heard some people playing flute music on a bone flute. Then you play them some Justin Bieber, they might be like, oh, this is the most amazing thing I've ever heard. But still not very good. So they haven't had the opportunity to compare, say, Justin Bieber with the Beatles to be able to note that, yeah, I mean, Justin Bieber might be cool if it's like the only like pop instrumental music you've ever heard, but if you compare enough cases, you're going to realize, yeah, it gets better. Don't think this is super great just because it's the best thing that you've heard. There's lots better stuff out there as well. So Hume says that once you've got a judge that is has all this experience, is free from prejudice, and is able to discern all of these sensations and feelings really well, the things that those judges say is beautiful and is artistically good, that is what is beautiful and artistically good. So there is an objective standard of what's good and what's beautiful. It's whatever these ideal judges say. Now you can think about this in terms of what we might be inclined to say about, say, the flavors of food. So we say, look, it's just a fact that lemons are sour. Now, it's also true that some people don't taste the sourness of lemons. Maybe there's something going on with their taste receptors, as I noted in perusal, you can chew these special berries that change your taste receptors temporarily so that when you eat a lemon, it actually tastes super sweet. And yet we still say, yeah, well, I get that it tastes sweet to you, but it's still sour. Why? Well, there's a sort of ideal judge. You might say, I don't know, a person with biologically characteristic taste receptors unimpeded by, the ingredients of the magic berry, such that when that person tastes it, they're going to taste sourness. And so we say, yeah, there's an objective fact of the matter whether lemons are sour or not, and it's constituted by the judgments of these ideal tasters. Hume is just saying, yep, that's the same thing with regards to art. Now, I'll leave it up to you whether Hume is right about that or not.